In 1999, Rayman 2 The Great Escape was released to universal acclaim, having successfully made the transition from 2D to 3D, a feat many mascot platformers had tried and failed to achieve. By this point, series creator Michel Ansel had been working almost exclusively on Rayman titles for the past 5 to 6 years, and needed a change of pace. He had so many ideas for other types of stories he wanted to tell, and decided that now would be an appropriate time to start work on something completely new, an action-adventure game starring a female protagonist with a heavy emphasis on puzzle-solving and stealth. This is the story of Beyond Good and Evil. Beyond Good and Evil, known as Project BG&E at the time, started development shortly after work on Rayman 2 had wrapped up, with many of the same people coming to work on the project. It was a very tight group of people that wanted to create something bigger and more ambitious, with the original goal being to pack a whole universe onto a single CD, and to make the player feel like an explorer, with a sense of absolute freedom. To accomplish this lofty goal, they decided to create an entirely new engine to take advantage of the PlayStation 2, rather than continuing to use the Rayman 2 engine, which wasn't built to handle the bigger, more open world they'd imagined. This new engine was called Jade, and was not only powerful, but versatile too. Its main strength was its tools, which allowed the team to try out new ideas easily. Everything seen on screen was done directly inside the engine itself. The team didn't rely on any external animation tools like Maya or 3ds Max. The benefit of this was that they could stop the game, animate something, change the background, or adjust the collisions, and then let the game continue without needing to exit out, reload, or recompile anything, which significantly improved the game's workflow. The engine's second strength was its ability to adapt to any kind of gameplay, whether that be exploring on foot, in a vehicle, or in a crowd. The critical parts of the engine were also optimized for each console to fully exploit their resources. With the power of the PlayStation 2's emotion engine, the CPU that powered the console, the team believed they could do whatever they wanted, so they designed the Beluga, the spaceship used to travel to the moon, with the intention of going from planet to planet, and an investigation that went beyond the scale of Hyllis, the planet where most of the game takes place. While making the game, Michel was reminded of Starglider, a 3D first-person combat simulator which he used to play as a kid. He remembered how you could go anywhere, and he wanted to do the same with BG&E, but various technical limitations, as well as the enormous amount of work needed to pull it all off, made such an idea unfeasible. This resulted in a lot of cuts being made to the story, along with several other things, which Michel found particularly frustrating. Over the course of the game's development, almost half of the team ended up moving away from the project, as it was just too complex to do this kind of game, and the team wasn't used to telling stories with deep meaning behind them. One person who didn't lose faith, however, was Ubisoft founder and CEO, Yves Guillemot, who was the project producer, and the only game he was ever producer on. He wanted something new, crazy, and ambitious, so he gave the team a lot of freedom to create the game they wanted, and spent time regularly with them. One of the first sparks of inspiration for BG&E came from a bug in Rayman 2, where it was possible to jump onto a pirate ship and travel all around the map. The team started imagining a game that would give players the same feeling of freedom. In most games, the feeling of freedom is fake. It might look like you can reach somewhere, but you can't. For BG&E, the team tried to imagine all the places the player would likely try to go, and what they might get frustrated that they can't do, so that they could design the game accordingly. The team also had a desire to tell something meaningful, a story that felt closer to home, and had something to say, instead of just being about beating the bad guys. The game's complicated nature meant that it went through multiple phases during its 4 years of development, resulting in a lot of back and forth between game design and scenario, which involved many rewrites. The game's story was originally all about Jade, a female protagonist doing something different, but then the September 11 attacks occurred while the game was still in development, and it awoke something much darker within the team, resulting in the game's narrative being changed. The strong propaganda about going to war and why it's necessary to do so was all connected to what was happening at this point in history. Additional inspiration came from real-world journalism and the feeling that you're not always being given all of the information, like waiting 6 months after a big event before finding out what actually happened. This then tied back into Jade's motivation to seek out the truth. Other inspirations for the game came from everyday life, like being able to get in a vehicle, move around freely, and take photos of places you like. The team were big fans of Hayao Miyazaki's work, which influenced the game's look. Paige can be taken as a nod to Porco Rosso, while Grave of the Fireflies was the film that inspired Michel to make something, leading to BG&E's development. Other films, like Blade Runner, influenced the game in other ways, specifically the mix of old things and new things in the same world, and the fact that the world has a history. They wanted players to have a sense that there's a backstory, and that the world hadn't only started spinning just because Jade showed up. As for the character introductions, those took inspiration directly from the movie Snatch. The Belgian comic book Tintin inspired Page's dialogue, specifically the side character Captain Haddock, who always got a word that nobody but him used. The team decided to mimic this for Page, with his particular word always revolving around food, because he's obsessed with it. At some point during development, it became clear that the game wasn't moving in a particularly interesting direction, partly due to the team not being used to making a game with a female character as the lead. So Michel asked everyone to attend an important meeting in order to discuss it. He made it clear that Jade was not a killer, and that she should only fight to defend herself, which initially concerned some members of the team, because they didn't know if it was going to be fun to play with this kind of character. During this time, very few games had female protagonists, and the ones that did, like Tomb Raider, often felt very cliched, with them basically acting like men. To avoid falling into the same pitfall, the team tried to make Jade her own entity, rather than just being a caricature of their collective male fantasies. They didn't want Jade to just be some bimbo with a gun in each hand and a fake vengeful look. They wanted her to remain feminine in her appearance, movements, and her manner of approaching things, like how her weapon is her camera, and how she finds other ways to solve problems, rather than using brute force. It proved to be one of the more challenging aspects of development, but fortunately they had some women on the team, so they were able to ask them if the way Jade's role was written felt true to her character. The lack of any weapons proved to be quite the problem, as Jade wasn't able to really defend herself, and it became frustrating for players to be facing danger but not being able to do anything about it. Jade's Daiju staff was later given to her for this exact reason, but it wasn't intended to be used as a weapon to kill people with. The initial idea behind Jade's camera came from the team wanting Jade's means of action to be mild, which itself resulted in the conspiracy theme, against which information is an effective weapon. It was also a way for players to influence the world. As you take pictures, exposing the truth, people join your cause and start protesting against the Alpha Sections, giving the player a sense that their actions have modified the world. Another reason for Jade's camera was because the team wanted players to really appreciate the world they had created. It was a way for them to encourage players to look around the environment without it feeling forced. Not only is the camera used to help uncover the conspiracy, but it's also used in Jade's other mission to catalogue all of the different species of creature for the Science Center. No matter where the player is or what they're doing, they'll always have a memory of nice things to look at during the game. The camera also ties into the stealth gameplay, featured later on, as it was a way to utilize the same observation gameplay for two different things. Not only does the player need to carefully observe the movements of the guards, but they also need to pay attention for anything they need to take pictures of. Michel's wife, Alexandria Ansel, worked as a character designer and played an important role in the development of Jade's character. It's rumored that she actually served as the main inspiration and muse for Jade's look and personality. Michel wanted to create a realistic lead character with a persona that players could connect to and identify with. Jade's original name was Sally, and her code name was Jade, but this was changed after the team was made aware that Sally isn't really a heroine name in English-speaking countries, so they simply made her code name her real name instead. It was while talking with Eddie Crew, who was the artistic director of voice recordings in the US, that they opted for Shawnee to be her new code name due to its exotic and tribal sound. The team wanted to avoid introducing Jade as the hero that would save the world, so at the beginning of the game, she's just someone who needs money, something everyone can relate to. Even the Black Isle mission, at the very start of the game, is just taking a picture for someone, which eventually leads to her being involved in more important things. The opening combat sequence wasn't added until much later on, as a way to bring some of the action closer to the start. The slow motion effect, meanwhile, was the team's way of expressing the fact that it's not just about killing enemies, and that there's always a desperate situation when Jade's fighting. As for why Jade is living with a bunch of orphan children, it was the team's way of showing that these people live apart from normal society, different people from different places trying to survive together. The biggest, most technically difficult part of the game's development was with the partner AI, to not only ensure they followed the player, but that they could also do all of the platforming the player does, specifically knowing when to wait for the player before jumping themselves. The AI partners, Page and Double H, are used as an additional action for the player with their own assigned button. The reason for doing this is because it's frustrating to have an AI that isn't doing what you want it to. So the team implemented a sort of synchronization button to direct the partner AI to whatever it is the player wants them to do. This gameplay was used to solve puzzles, and later on in the game, when Paige is taken away, the player begins to miss that functionality. These simple mechanics helped to create a connection between the characters, as it felt like they were an actual part of your adventure, rather than just simply tagging along. The Black Isle mission was created for the sole purpose of increasing the time spent with Paige, so that when he's separated later on, the player experiences this separation as painful. The Black Isle Mine was also the first level made for the game, so unsurprisingly, it was the team's main level for prototyping everything. Likewise, the Black Isle boss was the first boss they developed. Its design was inspired by an exotic fish, and Michelle was particularly fond of the two puppet eyes of the creature, but later came to realize that it was kind of stupid that he was just sitting there, doing funny things with its eyes as it waits for the player. The main theme for the level was the feeling of being underwater, with algae, jellyfish, and the like. The limousine featured in that mission was directly inspired by Tim Schafer's Full Throttle, as Michelle loved the whole vintage car's floating thing. The game's iconic radial menus were designed by Michelle himself, but at the beginning it was terrible, because nobody understood them, as it was the first time they'd done a circle menu that was controlled by the analog sticks. The code input menu was designed the same way, simply because Michelle wanted to reuse the main menu wheel for something else. His desire to justify every detail made everything more complex, but it also gave a real added value to everything they did. For example, for the inventory, they didn't want it to be pulled out from nowhere, so the very first time it's shown to the player, you see Jade's hand pressing the buttons to explain that this circle you're seeing is the inventory, which could also be seen attached to Jade's belt. This relatively simple visual explanation actually took the team several days to set up, but they were very much attached to the idea of a united world where everything has its place. The popular music track Propaganda, which plays in the Yakuda bar, was composed by Christoph Hirala, who made his debut as a video game composer with BG&E, having previously only scored film and television projects. The lyrics were taken from an actual recording of a phone conversation he got from a Bulgarian girlfriend. In the recorded telephone conversation, she talks about the power in place, the media, and propaganda, which just so happened to be the main theme of the game. Speaking of the Yakuda bar, sitting at a table near the stairs to the second floor is a guy called Rufus, who hides a code whenever the player gets too close to him. Originally, the idea was for the player to obtain this code by finding a good angle and using the camera zoom function to snap a picture from a distance. However, it turned out this wasn't necessary, because the brief moment it takes Rufus to cover up the code is just enough time for the full code to be read, without needing to use the camera at all. BG&E featured a number of different minigames, but rather than being simple diversions, the team decided to make them an actual part of the adventure, as the player is required to play these minigames in order to progress the story. For example, the gambling minigame in the Yakuda bar is used to gain access to the Iris Network secret base, while the hovercraft racing minigame is used to gain access to the slaughterhouse. Many people assume that the game's title, Beyond Good and Evil, is a reference to the Friedrich Nietzsche book of the same name, but the game really has no connection to the German philosopher. The game's original title was actually Between Good and Evil, which the marketing department didn't like very much. For Michelle, the meaning of this title was that you're always in the middle of an internal and external conflict, based on your conception of what is good and what is evil. In the game, and in the real world, propaganda thinks for you, telling you who your enemies are and who your friends are. When you go beyond the appearances, that's when you discover your own truth. After explaining this to the marketing department, they finally accepted the title and just replaced the between part with beyond instead, which fit better with the vast universe and story. BG&E had two E3 appearances. The first was at E3 2002, where Michelle presented the game to Shigeru Miyamoto and the late Nintendo president, Satoru Iwata, but they didn't really like it. There wasn't just one facet they took issue with either. Rather, they had problems with just about everything, from the backgrounds to the controls and even the camera. The one thing they did like was the relationship between Jade and Paige, where, during the fights, he helps you. Like when a creature pins Jade down, Paige will come and help her, and you can do the same for him. But it wasn't just Nintendo that was left unimpressed by BG&E, as, following E3, various publications failed to even mention the game, as they were more interested in writing about Half-Life 2 instead. So when the team arrived back in France, there wasn't anyone talking about their game online. the E3 2002 build of the game was a fair bit different from how the final game turned out. For starters, it was possible to access the Beluga right from the get-go, as the necessary upgrade part was found floating in the water. This was used to demonstrate how you could only access certain areas, like flying into a volcano, once you've unlocked specific upgrades for your hovercraft. Jade hadn't been given her Daijo staff at this point, so she fought enemies using a combination of hand-to-hand combat and magic. There were also apparently supposed to be 4-5 sidekicks in the final game that could follow Jade around as a squadron, but this idea never materialized, presumably due to technical limitations. Lastly, there were plans to let players send their photographs to friends online, but this feature was never implemented. The game's second E3 appearance was at E3 2003. After demoing the game at the event, Michelle decided to change Jade's appearance because he'd been telling people that Jade was an experienced woman and a reporter, despite the fact that she looked like she'd just finished high school. A lot of people thought her new design was a lot more militant, which it was. Since she needed to infiltrate dangerous places, her outfit needed to be believable. While many members of the team didn't initially respond well to the changes, as people played the game, they started to understand the changes more, and that there was a better connection to the world with her new model. Another reason why Michelle wanted to change Jade's model was because of what happened to Eco. He thought that there was a real risk of having too much disconnection between what they wanted to express and the way they expressed it, and he didn't want people to avoid the game simply because of its visuals. He also believed that young boys wouldn't want to play as a teenage girl straight out of high school. Beyond Good and Evil was released for the PlayStation 2 in North America on the 11th of November 2003 and arrived in Europe a few days later, with Xbox, GameCube and PC ports following shortly thereafter. The game received widespread critical acclaim, but in a jam-packed holiday season featuring the likes of Final Fantasy X2, Call of Duty and Ubisoft's own Prince of Persia, The Sands of Time, the game sadly failed to gain any traction. Within months of the game's release, retailers began heavily discounting the title in an effort to shift unsold inventory. One retailer, Circuit City, was reportedly selling the PlayStation 2 version for just $9.99. When asked about BG&E's poor sales years later, Michelle stated that one of the reasons he believed the game didn't sell well was because the camera was essentially the player's weapon, and it wasn't really clear what you were going to do in the game. He also noted how people at the time were obsessed with existing franchises and technological showpieces, and that BG&E would need time to be appreciated. The game's poor sales affected the entire team, as they were quite proud of the game and felt they'd done something pretty good. It was a mix of deep disappointment and pride despite everything. Jay Cohen, Ubisoft's Senior Vice President of Publishing, attributed the commercial failure of BG&E with the company not pushing the game as hard as they could. On the 28th of May, 2008, at the UbiDays 2008 event in Paris, Ubisoft founder and CEO, Yves Guillemot, showed off an in-engine teaser trailer for BG&E's untitled sequel. The game was in development for 18 months, having started pre-production in 2007, before being put on hold in the summer of 2009. The team was dissolved, with several of its members moving on to other Ubisoft projects, while Michelle started work on Rayman Origins. A short trailer of Jade running through a sprawling city was leaked in 2009, showcasing what the team had envisioned for the game. The same trailer was presented by Michelle 2 years later at a conference, together with various artworks and another video with in-engine footage. Michelle later revealed that the current generation of consoles was simply not powerful enough to realize the team's creative vision. He wanted to create a game where the investigation felt like it was yours, and depending on the direction you take, you'd lead a different story. While working on the game, they discovered that, technologically speaking, they were making something quite crazy, with cities, planets, and everything else they couldn't put into the first game. But it turned out they were running into the same problems. Even with the modern advancements of current console hardware, they still felt restricted in what they could do. Michelle decided that it would be better to work on a 2D game, rather than half of a 3D game, which is why he switched to working on Rayman Origins. Originally, BG&E 2 was said to be a direct sequel to the first game, with Michelle stating in an interview that players who liked the first should like the second. He very much wanted to make a sequel that was an improvement over the first, and suggested that they could add a new dimension with new planets, multiplayer, and lots of other ideas. One idea was to keep the multi-vehicle system of the first game, but with new multiplayer possibilities. He also stated that the sequel wouldn't have the same message as the original. Instead, the idea for the sequel was to be deeper and have more involved storytelling, unlike the linear story of the first game. He'd written the original story to be much longer, supposedly enough for a whole trilogy of games, but these plans never came to fruition. On the 30th September 2010, a HD remaster of BG&E was announced and set to release in the following year, on the 2nd of March 2011, for Xbox Live Arcade, and a few months later for PlayStation Network. The HD remaster featured a higher resolution, 60fps frame rate, improved character models, updated textures, and a fully remastered soundtrack, on top of added achievements and an online leaderboard. By the time the HD remaster was released, more and more people had learned about the game, developing a bit of a cult following. As such, the game did extremely well, but this success came far too late. After many years of silence, hints that BG&E 2 was in development began to resurface. In 2014, Michel revealed new concept art for Jade during a live Q&A with the Ubisoft Montpellier team. Then, in 2016, Michel began teasing BG&E 2 again, this time on his personal Instagram account, where he posted a piece of artwork for the game. Shortly thereafter, on the 6th of October 2016, Ubisoft announced on the official BG&E Facebook page that the sequel was in fact in development, and that Michel was working with his team at Ubisoft Montpellier to create it. Contrary to what many people probably expected, Michel wasn't the one who pitched the sequel to Ubisoft. According to Yves Guillemot, it was actually Ubisoft that approached Michel about finally making it. They convinced him that now was the right time for it, all of the planets were aligned, and all of the teams were ready to work with him on this project. The official announcement trailer for this new incarnation of BG&E 2 was shown during Ubisoft's E3 2017 press conference, alongside the first in-engine demo showing the game up and running. If you enjoyed this look back at the development of Beyond Good and Evil and its sequel, and would like to see more documentaries like this in the future, then please let me know by liking this video and subscribing to my channel. If you want to see all of my sources and research notes for this video, then feel free to follow the link in the description below to a public Patreon post where I've listed them. And while you're there, if you're able to throw a dollar or two my way, then that'd be most appreciated.